Brendan Small, the co-creator of the Adult Swim series Home Movies, is here to talk up his new series, Death Clock. You're already a fan, don't worry. Plus, we give the Xbox 360's full auto just 50 minutes before we start spreading rumors about it. Yeah, that's just how the first 50 rolls, man. Deal with it. And The Daily Show's resident expert, John Hodgman, fills us in on the areas of his expertise. His focus areas? Everything. Yeah, think about that. Now it's the only program that promises not to call the next morning. It's Attack of the Show!
Pick up on this.
To Attack of the Show. I'm Kevin Pereira, and today, wow, today we've got a... you know what, can we stop? I mean, let's just forget this. It's not right. Seriously, put it down. Put that stuff down. I don't know who we're kidding here. I don't know who I'm kidding. I just... This just doesn't feel right anymore. I'm sorry, guys. This whole feed at the top of the show crap, it's not working. No, don't worry. I'm sorry. It's not the feed's fault, and it's not your fault at all, Sarah. It's nobody's fault, really. It's just, you know, we've tried to mix things up here on the show a bit, and quite honestly, we've failed. You know, we failed ourselves, and more importantly, we failed you, the viewers. We forgot what made the top of this show so amazing. I think it's painfully obvious what's missing here. It's home base. You know, I've tried to pretend like everything's okay, you know, but I can't... I just can't stop thinking or dreaming about that fateful day when I told home base that we didn't want it anymore. We can't be together! Stop looking at me like that! I want you out of my life! Just go! Get out of here! Go on! You know, for months now, I've feigned comfort on that damn devil couch, but during each and every commercial break, I find myself loading up MySpace, frantically refreshing Homebase's profile just to see how happy she is without me. It's funny, I used to be in her top eight. You know, there were so many memories of us in her photos, that Depeche Mode concert at the Roxy or our trip to Cabo, our first kiss. I laid in bed for a week straight when I found out that she photoshopped me for some trashy leopard skin swivel chair from IKEA. It was clear to me then that, you know, Homebase moved on, but I didn't. We didn't. Attack of the Show didn't. And I think it's time that we stop lying to ourselves and lying to you, the viewers. We need to get back to what made this show spectacular. We need to bring back what made this show so amazing. So, guys, I don't know if we can... Let's just move the plasma out of the way. Let's bring back home base.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Can we just do it? Can we just bring back home base?
Sure we can, Sarah.
We can?
We can do what we want to do. Yeah! Let's bring back home base! Taking your calls for Home Movies and Death Clock creator Brendan Small.
Yeah.
So you can discover what makes, you know, what it takes to make a successful Adult Swim series.
Sure.
Number's 800-839-7880, and you can email us through our web form, attackoftheshow.com/askus. And you can chat with us as well. It's chat.g4tv.com.
That's right. Coming up after the break, co-creator of Home Movies, Brendan Small, tells us about his new Adult Swim series, Death Clock. We'll be right back. Small is the co-creator of Home Movies, an Adult Swim show that centered on, well, all sorts of stuff, like an 8-year-old who was a budding filmmaker, and a few of his friends just happened to be in elementary school.
You can't just make a movie backwards.
Oh, no. I can see that. That's the new thing. You know, all the directors are doing it, so...
But, Brendan, if we show the ending first, then won't that give away the ending?
Yeah, but no, because it's not really the ending.
Brendan, the movie's already written.
Right.
Forwards.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So you can't change it and just make it backwards.
No, I can. All the directors are doing it.
Yeah, Brendan, but those directors are hacks, and they're just looking for a hook.
Brendan, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So Home Movies, about an 8-year-old filmmaker named Brendan Small.
Yes, yes.
That is also your name.
Yes, yes.
Can we assume this is an autobiographical show?
It's mildly autobiographical, but if you have your own show and you name yourself after yourself, you can't get fired.
Very good point.
Yeah, it's true.
The star's gone. That is your voice.
That is my voice, yeah. They pitch it up a little bit digitally, so I sound younger, but...
Oh, interesting.
But yeah, that's what they do. But it is kind of autobiographical, in that I used to make movies as a kid.
Sure.
But yeah, that's kind of where it ended.
There's a little artistic license.
Yeah, there's a lot of artistic license, yes. Indeed.
Now, Home Movies, you started using squiggle vision, which is, for people familiar with something like Dr. Katz, that's sort of the technique.
Right, yeah.
You had since moved to flash.
Yes.
What is squiggle vision, first of all, so people know?
Squiggle vision is when you take an image that is like just one image and you make it, you give it the illusion of movement by making all the lines squiggle.
Okay.
And the reason we switched is because it looks horrible.
Right.
It looks horrible.
And then Flash is a lot easier. Probably a lot cheaper.
It's probably the same price, which is nothing. And that's how much it costs to make it look horrible. So we said, why don't we just make it look better for the same amount of money?
I mean, that's the idea.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's your show and you want it to succeed.
I figured it's my show, we may as well make it look good.
Home Movies is doing well on DVD.
Yes, it is. Doing
now,
very well, yeah.
In the past, shows like Family Guy have seen they've come back to life.
Yes.
Because of good DVD sales.
Exactly.
Is that something that you're looking forward to with Home Movies?
That's a good question, because I just talked to the Home Movies DVD distributor.
Okay.
And we only have to sell 48 billion more copies to get it back on the air, and... It's a done deal.
That's 48 billion.
Yeah.
That's like in one weekend.
We sold 40 copies.
40.
And then, you know.
So you need like 8 billion.
I don't.
That's
you,
not
you
even
the
right math.
You do the math.
No, listen to me.
I'll tell you this. The new season of Home Movies, the fourth season or the last season, is coming out on DVD.
Perfect.
May 16th. And it's going to come with a nice CD of all the music that I wrote for the show.
So, well, I mean, you heard it here. Just a few more billion, and Home Movies will come back
Help
on the air.
Help us out, folks.
But all is not lost here, because even if Home Movies is living in DVD, you've got a new show that's coming to Adult Swim.
That's right.
He's got a new show. It's called Death Clock. So what's Death Clock, and is it like Home Movies?
No.
No, not at all.
It's nothing like
Complete
Home
departure.
Movies. The cool thing about Home Movies was that I got to write all the music for the show.
Mm-hmm.
And this show is all about music. It's all about metal. It's about black metal, death metal. It's about Norwegian, Scandinavian
metal. As in heavy, scary
metal. Very scary.
It
would probably be too scary for you.
I don't know, Brendan. You don't know me. You don't know me, man.
Well, we'll see. But but this is about a band called Death Clock.
Okay.
And there's going to be murder. It's going to be
there's
vicious.
There's going to be murder.
There's
oh, maybe a, this is a little scary.
There's
going to
be a very high death count. And it's not going to feel or look anything like Home Movies, but I guarantee that it will be awesome.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
All right, so we can look forward to that. I wanted to ask you, since there's so many people that seem to be doing well with animation that's geared towards adults.
Yeah.
Adult Swim is a good example.
You know,
the Family Guys, the Simpsons, you know, they were sort of the forefront of this whole thing.
Yeah.
Is animation not for kids anymore? I mean, can we safely say that? Because for so long it was children cartoons.
No, that's a good question, because I think the way that I look at animation is not so much as like cartoons or not cartoons. I think the cool thing about Adult Swim is they've created a place where a really cool style of comedy can happen.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not about animation or anything. It's about having a very unique sense of humor and having this playground where you can go crazy. And that's the cool thing about Adult Swim. It's not about whether or not it's animated for me.
And you also don't have to work with difficult actors who aren't that funny.
No, you do. A lot.
Yourself.
I have
as an animated
had to
character.
Try to direct myself on a number of occasions, and it's horrible.
And it's awful.
I'm awful to work with.
A real prima donna.
Yes.
You come across that way.
I almost didn't come out to this show because I felt fat.
You don't look it. You really don't. If that's any.
That's because I threw up right before I get on. Oh. I don't want to talk about it.
I do that too. Cold followings. Home movies. I know. I'm just, there are a lot of these shows seem to be successful because they get a cult following.
Yes.
And the people really mean it.
Yeah.
For someone who's on the other side, what kind of shows are you sort of a cult fan of?
The Office.
Yeah.
UK Office. Drives me crazy.
Not animated.
Well, no, but it's still very good. It's amazing. It's the best show I've ever seen on TV, and I'm jealous and furious when I watch it.
Yeah,
that's how I get.
That you're not a part of it.
Yeah, and it's been canceled, so it's too late for me to.
See, for me, The Office is a little too close to home.
Oh yeah.
It's sad, rather than funny. It's like, oh yeah.
I must be a tragic clown.
Yeah. Brendan, thank you so much for being on the show, and we look very forward to Death Clock and Home Movies. It's gonna sell those billion DVDs. I just know
it's gonna be awesome.
I just know it.
It's gonna be awesome.
Pick up the season 4 collector set of Home Movies on May 15th, and look for Death Clock, as Brendan mentioned, in August on Adult Swim. Now, still ahead, The Feed will give you all the news that's fit to squeeze into a 6-minute block of television, presented by moi. And Kevin's first 50 review of Full Auto features guns, cars, and kittens? Okay. That's all right after this.
Guests on Attack of the Show receive iDogs. Little dog, big sound.
Welcome back to the AOTS. We are about as live as TV gets, so be sure to watch out for the old nip slips. You know what I'm saying? Now, everyone knows that all good decisions are made in under an hour, and that's why when a new game comes out, well, we here at Attack of the Show, we give it a 50-minute test run. So get ready, folks. It's time for the first 50. The game is Full Auto. It's an Xbox 360 exclusive from developers Pseudo Interactive. Now, they were on the show a little while back. I chatted candidly with the developer, but now it's my time to really sink my teeth into it and let you all know what's really going on with this game. Now, I was confused by the storyline with this one at first. You see, in the beginning of the game, you start out there's so many characters and plot points that it's really... All right, it's a racing game without a story, so there's absolutely nothing to show there. But we do have Copycat, the world's first clone kitten. Folks, that's the world's first clone kitten right there. Yeah, anyway, game's all about physics and crazy gameplay. So here we go. Even without a storyline, Full Auto is really going to push the limits of in-game racing physics. Of course, it is a next-gen title, so as you can see, the dang thing is purdy, folks. It screams along, especially when you're using the old nitro boost, and everything is destructible. When I say everything, I mean everything. Go through sides of buildings. I caught a ramp at one point and took out entire balconies of a building. Absolutely everything can be destroyed, and there's lots of detail in the objects that you are destroying, from damaged cars to dented barrels. It's all there. And right there, see that little rewind there? This isn't Prince of Persia hanging out. He's not riding shotgun and rewinding things. It's a feature called Unwreck. So if you missed a sweet jump, or you slammed into a wall and came to a dead stop, you hit a little shoulder button, you rewind, you're good to go. Now, there is the boost, which allows you to catch up to your opponents, but the sad thing is, and I really didn't notice this until I got my hands on the controller, the game kind of feels on the slow side until you actually start to boost it. You know, once you hit the nitrous, then you get a sense of speed, but until then, it actually kind of feels a little on the sluggish side. But then you blast your way through your opponents and you get going, and that's nice because there's a lot of cars and a lot of different weapons in the game. There are 21 playable vehicles. Nice car models, they look pretty, they have different swatches of paint, if that's your deal. But none of them are licensed, and the other big deal is that they all kind of act the same. And you'll see here, the physics on the cars are actually incredibly loose. Everything feels rather floaty. You don't get a sense that you're in this hulking junk of metal cruising down the road. You just kind of feel like you're almost hovering on top of the road. But there's 8 unique weapon types. You've got hood-mounted shotguns, rail guns, rocket launchers, mines, unlimited ammo, which is also sweet, 18 different tracks to race through, and over 80 racing events to unlock. So there's plenty there. The problem is it all kind of feels the same. You know, you unlock track 13, and it feels a lot like track 7, and oh yeah, a whole lot like track 1 through 6 as well. But there is multiplayer to mix things up. There's some 2-player split-screen action, which is there. As you see, the frame rate get a little chuggy during some intense moments. It's not the hottest when it gets that way. And then there's these jump cinematics that happen all the time when you go off these ramps where it kind of takes you out of the action. But thankfully, those are optional. The developers were smart. You can take them out. You can play up to 8 different players anywhere on Xbox Live. That's full featured. And we're talking Sega here, so you're guaranteed some great arcade action. So kittens beware. You know, the impressive physics engine and 360 horsepower. Yeah, there we go. Means you got to have the helmet on because debris will become flying at you in all directions. So Full Auto, it's in stores tomorrow for the Xbox 360. You can pick it up for that special someone who suffers from short-term memory loss because they won't notice the repetition. Stick around after the break. We look at some sex fetishes that are sure to cause some awkward moments at the dinner table tonight. And the feed gives you all the news that you need to be a hit at the parties. You guys go to news parties, right? Talk headlines?
You're watching G4, the number one podcasted network in America.
Wall-to-wall game reviews.
Always expect the unexpected.
Go to iTunes or G4TV.com for details.
Welcome back to Attack of the Show, always live and always happy to see you. Yes, even you. Coming up, Home Movies co-creator Brendan Small will take your phone calls. Plus, Sarah scoops up more gems of the internet. And the master of everything, John Hodgman, joins us right here on the old devil couch. But here it is, back where it belongs. It's the feed. Hit me, Sarah!
The feed? This late in the show? I'm totally thrown off here. The remake of the classic Peter Sellers comedy, The Pink Panther, starring Steve Martin and Beyoncé Knowles, was number one at the box office this weekend. The crime caper netted $21.7 million, just narrowly beating out the number two film, Final Destination 3. Rounding out the list are Curious George in the third slot and Firewall at number four. Also worth noting, the American viewing public lost a collective 12 million IQ points. Can't something worthwhile open, please? It's February. Now, more news out of Disney, or should we call it Disnar? Because Pixar honcho John Lasseter is claiming that the new Toon powerhouse is not giving up on traditional 2D hand-drawn animation. At least until they figure out a way to negate the contracts of Pappy and Milt. You know, those lovable two animators who still refer to Walt Disney as the kid. Pappy would also like to know which one of them computer brats keeps stealing his mechanical pencils. Now, a filmmaker funded by disaster quote-unquote relief organization FEMA apparently used the footage he shot of the World Trade Center site in an adult film. And since he never signed over title and ownership of the footage, FEMA is powerless to do anything about it, which is, you know, a position that FEMA knows all too well. Now, as you probably heard over the weekend, Vice President Dick Cheney shot a man, and thusly, internet fertilizer is born. A You're the Man Now dog is already up, no surprise there, showing Cheney in the classic NES game Duck Hunt. By the end of the day today, this is going to rival Snakes on a Plane for most bizarre internet references ever. On a more serious note, I, for one, am glad that this story is getting some much-needed attention. White billionaire on white billionaire crime is so rarely reported, and we can no longer ignore this problem. Speaking of which, diminutive New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg, hey, short people unite, apparently thinks work time is not playtime. While touring the city's legislative offices in Albany, Bloomberg allegedly saw an employee playing solitaire. The next day, that man was fired. To make matters worse, the man had to wait 3 hours for a train home because the dude in charge of MTA relations was kicking ass at Minesweeper. It's a good game. MySpace is apparently bragging that it now draws 2.5 times more traffic than Google. While this sounds pretty unbelievable, keep in mind that a good 85% of that traffic is just people changing over their song lyric quote. Sorry, they're just not into Good Charlotte anymore. And finally, German automakers BMW and Mercedes-Benz are ready to unveil dashboard-mounted night vision monitors. The technology is expected to roll out with both the Mercedes S-Class and the BMW 7 Series, which are due to arrive on U.S. shores later this year. An unimpressed representative from Ford shrugged, whatever, what's the big deal? We've always had grille-mounted devices that help you see in the dark. They even have a high beam setting. And now, brain, meet headlines. Aviator Steve Fawcett flew 3 straight days, then into Richard Branson's arms. Ryan Singer says his Logan's Run script is finished. Blizzard apologizes to gay World of Warcraft players. Singular introduces global roaming and high-speed wireless network. Hackers have cracked open the Xbox 360's file system. And that's the feed. Didn't that just feel right?
Now, everyone knows that if it exists, you can find it on the internet. That's a given. But every once in a while, you know, I stumble across some sites that, well, they make me feel a little funny and, to be honest, a little guilty. But I'm not sure if I should have any actual guilt over these feelings, so I called on my spiritual advisor, Father Walsh, and asked, does this count as sex? You see, Father, it's like this. I dropped my cell phone the other day, and this woman accidentally stepped on it with her high-heeled shoe, and I just, well...
I had a bit of a trouser sneeze, did you?
I'm sorry?
Go on, my son.
Right, well, I want to know if something like this even counts as actual sex. I mean, does it?
Well, yes and no. You see, my son, this is a case of what we might call corumpophilia, sexual gratification derived from seeing inanimate objects crushed.
Oh, so it's not just limited to phones, then?
Oh, heavens no. No, for some people, it's fruit or cigarettes or even toy cars.
Wow, that's... Okay, well, how about this one, then? How about this one? You know, I work as the side gig as a clown, as you know, on the weekends.
And I don't approve of that, but yes.
Yes, Father, I'm sorry. But the other day I was blowing up a balloon for a young lad, and it was incredible.
Oh, yes, yes. Behold a new Jerusalem.
Yes, bingo, yes. Bingo. What is that?
Well, that's inflatiophilia, which, interestingly enough, derives its name from the same Latin root as our word for flatulence.
Yeah, I didn't need to know that, Father.
Philistine.
Right. So what is this about?
Well, if you enjoy this sort of thing, you're a lunar.
Oh, so lunars are people who get off on blowing up balloons?
Yeah, not just blowing up balloons. Some are also stimulated by the color, the texture, or the smell of the balloon itself.
Oh. Wait a minute, they get off on the smell of the balloon? That's and that's kind of weird, don't you think?
Well, I'm not one to judge.
Okay, true. Now, what do you think of this one? The other day I was shopping for surgical supplies, like I do on the weekends.
As you're wont to do.
And I saw this box of adult-sized diapers. You know,
dear.
No. I mean, listen, at first I thought, you know, that would be so convenient. But then when I really got to thinking...
Oh, boy, where does the time go?
Father, I just...
Hello? Yes, please hold, Your Holiness. Kevin, I really should take this.
Your phone didn't even ring, Father.
Not everybody hears the call. Now, shoo.
I'm more confused than ever, but thank you, Father Walsh. Time for a break, folks, but we'll be right back with Gems of the Internet and The Daily Show's resident expert, John Hodgman.
The Feed is brought to you by Volkswagen. On the road of life, there are passengers and there are drivers.
On the next Attack of the Show, a certified dominatrix will show you how to tie someone up. Oh, just in time for Valentine's Day. Plus, Chris Gore graces us not just with his presence, but also that of his favorite DVDs of the week. He calls it DVD Tuesday. And we'll have another nail-biting round of our Hottest Girl of MySpace competition. All that on the next Attack of the Show. Tune in if you don't believe us. After wowing them on something called the Daily Show with Jon Stewart, our next guest is finally up in the big leagues. He's finally arrived. He's the author of the hilarious new book, The Areas of My Expertise. Ladies and gentlemen, we have an audience for you today, John. It's a big deal. John Hodgman,
hello,
welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
They gather when they sense excellence, which is why they're normally absent from the studio. But today...
I thought they were forced to be here.
Well, we did send out a memo.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But they showed up nonetheless, which speaks volumes.
Right, I wrote that memo, actually.
Your tie draws them in.
Yeah, of course.
You've been dubbed sort of the Daily Show's resident expert.
Yes.
And what are... I mean, I know you get asked this often, but with a title such as The Areas of My Expertise...
My book.
Your book there, mm-hmm. Words You Wrote.
Yes.
What are the areas of your expertise, John?
Oh, they're pretty wide-ranging. Mm-hmm. Literary matters, matters historical, matters cryptozoological, hobo matters, food,
hobo matters.
Drink, and cheese, which is a kind of food.
I've been told.
Haircuts and utopia.
Wow.
A lot of stuff about snowballs, you know, anything. Anything at all that falls within the areas of my expertise, which is most subjects.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No sports, though. No sports.
I watch a lot of the Fox News, and I know from watching that it's possible for someone to consider themselves an expert without actually being
indeed.
Qualified
then
whatsoever.
You already know the qualifications for expertise.
Exactly.
What amount to zero.
What does qualify you, though? Do you have a certificate? Are you accredited?
If you can convince someone to put you on television, then you are automatically an expert on any subject.
That's true. Does not apply to cable television, though. I don't know if you're aware.
Well, we're working on
anybody
that.
Can get on that.
Yes.
It's barely above public access at this point.
Yes, yes, yes. But they're all experts anyway.
All right.
Also, I had a lot of help because I was a freelance magazine writer for a time. So I had to learn a lot of stuff about, like, the history of vodka and chronic knee pain and hangover cures and learn all this stuff and write it down. And then instead of forgetting it, I just filed it away into a book.
And it's phenomenal. The,
yes,
the book
exactly.
has no actual order or anything. You just sort of kind
no.
of spit it out there.
No, putting it in order seemed like pointless busy work to me.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Let's just fill pages.
Yeah, exactly. It's just the way it came out. Now I have to rearrange it, cut and paste. No.
Oh, no, 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 no.
No, no, no.
That's
even
word
my
processing.
Interns
that's
do
too
that.
Advanced.
Yes, exactly so.
I arrived here this afternoon from New York.
Good.
Crazy blizzard.
Yeah.
Lots of snow.
So I've heard.
Yeah, it's real. It's legit.
Yes.
I blogged it. But there weren't any kids playing.
See, just
in
because
snow.
You blog something, it's so. You are an expert all of a sudden on blizzards.
Well, I don't mean to toot my own horn, John.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
beep beep.
Yeah, no.
and there were no kids playing in the snow, and I thought
no.
maybe it's because they're asthmatic, but I know that you've got them covered because there's a whole page or paragraph or two dedicated to children that suffer from asthma who, and you give them diversions when they can't play in the
yeah,
snow.
Yeah, well, my book, I had mentioned snowballs before.
Yes.
So I have
not
some
the
basics.
Internet fetish, the actual.
Wow.
Did I just, did I go out of your area of expertise, or?
I'm very confused now.
Okay, well, let's get back to the
no,
weather
I'd like
phenomenon.
To hear more about the internet fetish.
Well, can we bring back Father Walsh?
Yes, I
think
exactly
I
so.
Now, what diversions do you have for those who cannot
play? Well,
yes,
some children, like most of the children in New York City, cannot play out in the snow right. due to the asthma. So they can then do other things that I suggest, like stare at the ceiling.
Always a good one.
Yes. Loathe birds because they can fly, for example. That's a handy pastime.
It is.
Inhaler whittling, for example.
Inhaler yeah. whittling.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm an asthmatic person myself, and I made this little baby myself back when I was 13.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yes.
I like that.
Hello,
it,
old
injection
friend.
Molded? Or
yes. What's that?
Injection molded?
No, just some balsa wood and a pocket knife.
Fantastic. You are,
yeah.
you are an expert, sir.
And then some medicine.
In your book, you recount the timeline of the lobster. Do you need a second?
Okay. I do this all the time.
Fantastic. You recount the history of the lobster in America, which I did not
correct.
Know had it was
it
so
is
rich.
Not, yes, it's right. And the lobster is not native to Maine. Many people think that it is. But it was imported to Maine by Teddy Roosevelt, who had to get them out of New York City because they had been killing children. And they're everywhere.
And now when you bring up lobster, we think, you know, they're in a tank
you
at the red lobster.
You think of the thing with claws,
exactly,
for
not the original lobster.
No, there was a creature in Maine called the lobster, which was a kind of sea otter. Mm. But once the crustaceans came up, they had to fight for territory. And unfortunately, the furry old lobster, as it was known.
Look at them. They're adorable.
When, yes, I know. Aren't they cute? There
wow.
you go. That's a lobster right there.
I did not know. John,
yeah.
I'm fascinated, and I'm glad you share your expertise with
it became
this world.
Extinct, the poor thing. Thank you very
it's
much.
It's a sad story, but we thank you for sharing it, John.
Oh, yes. No, that's
thanks
fine.
For coming on
thank
the old
you,
show.
Kevin. Yeah.
There's plenty more where that came from, folks. You can pick up John's new book and visit John's website, areasofmyexpertise.com. But now, I understand that you've arranged a very special Attack of the Show performance.
Yes, when I do presentations from the book, I bring along a Dan Fogelberg-like guitarist to sing cloying folk songs
oh.
of his own devising. His name is Jonathan Colton.
He's like a personal bard, or?
Yes, he's my troubadour.
That's
exactly
sweet.
So.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
All right, well, ladies and gentlemen, now here's Jonathan Colton with Furry Old Lobster.
As a young boy, I'd follow the path down past the dunes to the sea. There on the warm sandy beaches we'd lie, the furry old lobsters and me. They'd whistle and squeal as they ran through the waves, so sleek, so furry and fair. But now when I go down to find my old friends, the beaches are empty and bare. Sing hey heidi ho, where the old lobster go, and his body's so furry and brown. Sing oh heidi hey, have they all gone away, for we haven't seen many around. New York sends a monster to darken our seas, cursed be the day that it came. They are ugly and small and not tasty at all. They are lobsters in nothing but name. They don't smash open clams on their bellies with stones. They have neither whiskers nor paws. And the old furry lobster so easily crushed in the grip of their terrible claws. Sing hey, hidey-ho, where'd the old lobster go? When his body's so furry and brown. Sing oh, hidey-hey, have they all gone away? For we haven't seen many around. No, we haven't seen many around. No, we haven't seen many around. Furry old lobster.
Enjoyed that nonsense, you'll probably like the twisted science show Brainiac. It's on tonight at midnight as part of the Barbed Wire Biscuit right here on the old G4. But now, time for calls with Brendan Small. Brendan, thank you for agreeing to take some calls.
Absolutely.
From our rabid fans. We have Grant on the phone from Columbia, Missouri. Are you there, Grant?
Yeah, I'm here.
How you doing today, bud?
I'm doing really well.
All right, you have a question?
Yeah, it's concerning the script of the show.
Yeah.
Left me and the rest of Star Sing wondering how much of the show is improvised?
Yeah, it's a cartoon. You pretty much have to go what's off the page, or no?
No, not at all. I mean, me and the other writer, Bill Broaddus, for Home Movies, we would write these scripts, and they were the right amount of, you know, words for a show. But we would, all the actors, we'd bring them in, and we would we'd kind of go through each scene, and then we would we'd go off page, and we'd improvise a lot. And the final product was a combination of written and improvised. And that would always change. But we're doing the same thing with my new show, Death Clock, too. A lot of improvisation, just keeping it conversational, keeping it very kind of real and low-key.
Do you ever find yourself, like, in the VO booth, reading the page, and then going, well, hold on, I didn't just adding something else to it or continuing?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. We'll try to, sometimes it's just the line isn't working because I'm a terrible writer. And then I'll have to.
That's
what
I blame any lines on the show when they don't work.
What happened here? Why couldn't I write that well? I'll try to think of something else. So it's kind of not doing a great job writing and then trying to fix it on the spot and trying to save the show.
Fix it in post, as they
say.
All right,
exactly.
We have Ashton on the phone. Are you there, Ashton?
Yeah, I am.
How you doing today?
I'm pretty good. How about you?
Doing fantastic. Pet your
fantastic
cat for me. Yeah, you have a question?
Yeah, I do. I was wondering where you got the inspiration for Coach McGurk at.
Coach McGurk, the soccer coach on Home Movies. Good question. It's funny. We knew that we wanted a soccer team and kids playing on the show. But we basically that was all. I can't take any credit for it. That was John Benjamin, the actor, who came in and just kind of nailed a character. He just came in and he just started goofing off, and he came up with this very layered, strange character who has, you know, a mother complex and hates himself and a drinking problem. So I can't take credit for that. I wish I could. I you know, later wrote for that character, but that's all John Benjamin, the actor.
Awesome.
Know?
Good stuff. Yeah. Brendan, thanks for taking the calls. We
Absolutely.
Appreciate it. Thanks for stopping by.
Cool.
What's that? What's that twinkle in Sarah's eyes? Oh, it's those gems of the internet.
Kevin.
Yes, Sarah.
I feel like today.
I decided to moonwalk today. I'm sorry. I wanted to switch it up.
Can you do more?
No, I can't.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I hurt my back, actually.
All right. This is sort of a time for you to chill out and kind of let your heart go pitter-patter a little bit, because it's sort of a Valentine-inspired gems. Oh,
that's right, that's
internet.
This week.
Well, it's tomorrow, actually. Oh, so we're going to start off with something that I think you all out there will like, and those are Star Wars Valentines, Kevin.
Yes.
Star Wars Valentines. These, of course, are Valentines for Star Wars fans. It's really, really very simple. For example, here's the Wookiee to my heart.
I got it.
Don't you love that? I mean, I would love to get that. Or here, Anakin would love to learn to love sand for Padme.
Gotcha.
I actually didn't get that one, but I figured that you would.
Sure. It's it's from one of the movies, the one with the, they were lightsaber dueling.
The one with the sand.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. Totally. It makes sense now. And then finally, Han will be considerate tonight.
I like that.
He won't.
There's one like,
first.
My love for you will stay on target,
not tonight.
Which is great.
Get it? Get it? Yeah, it's good. It's
These fun. Are from Something Awful,
Something
right?
Awful
they had the little Photoshop Friday.
Where we found them, and Star Wars Valentine's. I mean, you can't go wrong. Well, while we're thinking of things that are cute and cuddly and Valentine-like, how about a puppy monorail? Yes, you heard it here.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
This is actually, somebody built this, and the guy who created it is a member of the Monorail Society, so he is not fooling. This is serious business.
That's adorable.
Apparently, when you read more on the site, you find out that they are Native American puppies.
Oh.
Not really sure how that works out.
And that's
but,
their
but
last trip, the, right? That's when they're on their way to be put down for.
Stop it, Kevin.
Oh, what?
No, those puppies were all adopted later in the day after riding the monorail.
Because that's what my parents would say. Oh, your dog's you know,
going out to the farm.
Spike's gonna ride the monorail. And it's like, oh, what does that mean? And then
the
I never saw him again.
I would say that that's the best gem ever. But they were puppies, not kittens. So really close. I mean, damn near. Finally, Kevin.
Oh, there's more.
Of course, there's three gems, and we're getting to the third and final gem.
What is it?
This really requires some fanfare here. You know, on Valentine's Day, you might give your loved one a bouquet of flowers.
Yes.
How about a bouquet of tampon flowers, Kevin? That's right. Flower bouquets made of nothing else but tampons. You can color them so they don't all have to be white. You know, or off-white if you're not into the bleaching tampon kind of material. So you can go, you know, how to make hibiscus flowers, daisies, and daffodils. There are actually how-tos on the tampon site, Kevin, which is really cool. It also shows how to make heart earrings. So, you know, there's just a little twine. You know, you dip the tampon in a little red color 40. And, Oh, my God. I think he's dead. You all right?
Yeah.
Cool?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I'm good.
All right. You can find all my gem links at attackoftheshow.com. Just like always, Kevin.
Right.
You know, at least something's consistent around here, you know?
Yeah.
You
great.
Know?
Yeah.
Tampons.
Fantastic.
Tampons.
Stop it.
Tampons.
Stop it.
You and I have unfinished business, people, like those emails and chat questions you always go on about. But first, here's a taste of what kind of music makes our workday slightly more productive. Shut up, Kevin.
Hearing aids. Tom Beck, we have sound. LCD sound system, self-titled. Fisher Spooner, Odyssey. James Blunt, Back to Bedlam. Death from Above, 1979. You're a woman, I'm a machine.
We can do what we want to.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Attack of the Show, live every day right here. Now, just a reminder that user-created deadline, it's creeping up on you, so send us a mystery box of anything, absolutely anything, anything at all. Just keep it within federal, state, and local laws, of course. You can get all the details at g4tv.com/user-created. Do it! Dance, my puppets!
And also be sure to tune in on Wednesday because our own comic book goddess Blair Butler went to WonderCon, and she got a chance to discuss capes and cod pieces with none other than Superman Returns director Bryan Singer.
That's
Why
awesome.
Didn't we get to go?
I was stuck in a blizzard.
She's kind of the comic book expert, though, so it makes sense.
Yeah, totally.
You were stuck in a blizzard. I just was hanging.
Yeah. I was drunk in bed
I was
again.
Sleeping, yeah, with my bottle of vodka.
How comforting.
Very cozy.
Sarah, throughout the show, we are live, as we said several times today.
Yeah.
But we're also interactive. You know,
we
care about the viewers and the kids at home. We want to know what they have to say, and we want to answer questions that they have.
Yeah, questions that we've selected.
And selected for comedy gold, clearly.
Are you ready for one?
Let's do some questions.
Okay, Can't Shoot a Duck asks, hey, did Kevin ever get to third base with home base?
Yes. Oh, yeah. I had an in-the-park home run.
Can I ask you something, Kevin?
Sure.
There's some dispute over the years of what constitutes first, second, and third. I know what home base is.
Right.
But what is third base?
Action in the front, not the back.
Really?
You know, everybody's scale is slightly skewed, but yeah, for me, it's pretty
much... Action in the front, not the back?
Yeah.
That's only third base?
Well, yeah.
Wow.
I'm really good at baseball.
And you went home with home base?
Oh, yeah, slid right in.
He's amazing.
Next question.
Okay, Ageless Angler wants to know, what would be the first thing the host would do if an embarrassing home movie was leaked to the net?
I'd celebrate. I'd have a viewing party.
Yeah, because if it's on the net, I mean, there's nothing you can do about it, so you might as well just try to have fun.
Yeah.
And just say, I wanted to. I meant to.
You can be all Colin Farrell and send cease and desist orders everywhere to try and get the old teeth-picking video removed from the
net.
It'll
just get out, and then you'll look foolish and sad and...
Yeah, the cat's out of the bag.
Say,
let it go. And it's
I'm
on the floor
man.
In the apartment.
It's cool.
Did you see the Colin video, by the way?
Yeah.
Very embarrassing.
Really?
Really embarrassing.
Just stop talking.
Ruin my fantasy.
Please.
I don't want to sleep with him.
Okay, ready for the next question?
Yeah, let's
our next
more.
Interactive question with our viewers.
Yes.
Honest Hype wants to know, what recent event would the host rewind, a la Full Auto, if given a chance?
Ooh.
Recent event to rewind, Kevin.
Sure.
You do embarrassing stuff all the time. Anything you'd like to take back?
No, you know, I don't often get embarrassed because of that. I really just don't care.
It's amazing, actually, the way that you are that way.
Seriously, I feel like I can do what I want to do. You know what I mean?
I do.
I was hoping we were going to hear the song. Darn. All right. That's it. I did want to mention that you can hear more from John Hodgman's Troubadour at Jonathan Colton's website, jonathancolton.com. That is a website on the internet.
No.
That has information
really?
And multimedia.
You don't say. Yeah. Thanks to John and, of course, Brendan Small. We'll see you guys, I don't know, when we see you, I guess.
Yeah, we'll be around. You'll be around.
Or not.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's cool.